Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Thanksgiving is over, which means it's time again for the NHL regular season. And as always, I'm Dan Stevenson alongside Matt DeBorg, and we're back for the 2016-27 NHL season. Matt, you ready?
Oh, very much so.
As the Flames have been saying in all their marketing material, it's go time.
Yeah, looking forward now that Gaudreau's under contract, looking forward to the regular season and seeing how this team does.
Well, that's probably the biggest story of the week. Gaudreau's contract finally got done. We're a couple days away from the season starting. And Johnny Gaudreau, we've talked about every week, got done. He didn't miss any season games as we expected that he wouldn't. The deal is a six-year deal at $6.75 million per year average. And it's kind of funny because if you look back at what the rumors were, the Flames were offering about $6.75 million. He wanted $8 million. We figured they'd settle in a 7-point-something range, but it looks like the Flames win on this one. I know about you. I think there's a fantastic deal.
Yeah, and it would have been more if the Flames were getting 7 or 8 years. Like, I think if he would have went the full term, you're looking probably at a 7.375 or 7.5 million per season. So to get him under $7 million, that's a bargain for the next 6 years. And with how the Flames contracts are laid out, it will allow some flexibility to make adjustments down the road. Because like Brody in a couple of years ends, then the year after that Hamilton ends, then Giordano and Gaudreau end, and then Monahan's ends. So it will allow some flexibility so we don't have like all of our contracts ending all in the same year and like having the problem that Chicago did where they had to like blow up their entire team because of the fact that they just did not have the room to sign all of their players at the same time.
Yeah, we don't want Monahan and Gaudreau coming up on the same year again.
No. Like, it was enough of a problem that it took until today to figure out how to get a first-line right winger. So, you know, you don't need that kind of a crunch where you're forcing somebody into the lineup who's simply not good enough.
So Johnny Gaudreau will receive a $3 million signing bonus this season and another $3.5 million signing bonus in the 2021 season, which could be the next lockout. And as an interesting note, he has a modified no-trade clause in only 1 year of the contract, his last year, the 21-2022 season, in which he'll finally be a UFA. And that contract lists that there's 5 teams in which he can be traded in the league. And it's being rumored that one of those teams actually is the Philadelphia Flyers that is on that list or will be on that list. And Gaudreau's actually said in the past that at some point in his career, he wanted to play for the Philadelphia Flyers. So it doesn't surprise me they're on there. I'm curious if he has to submit that list now or if he can wait, because I imagine that if you look at how long this deal is, we're going to have a very different, you know, selection of top and bottom in 6 years.
You mean Edmonton may make the playoffs by then?
Well, I'm not thinking Edmonton. Nobody's ever said Edmonton's on my list. But, you know, a team like Chicago, who's a little bit older, they may be going through a bit of a rebuild then.
I know. I'm just making a shot at Edmonton because why not?
Yeah, so I don't know when that has to go in there, but I think at 6.75, the Flames maintained what they wanted, which is his contract is in line with the captain. His contract is in line with Mark Giordano, who's also making $6.75 million. And, I mean, that's something that they've stuck to. Nobody makes more than the captain, and I'm glad to see that they were able to stick with that and, you know, stay within budget. And I think that it's a great deal. And hopefully if Gaudreau keeps getting better by the end of this deal, it's going to look like a fantastic contract.
Well, you also got to figure that with all of the players on the Flames, they've taken a little less than market value. Like Gaudreau's contract's a little cheap. Monahan's a little cheap. Brody, Hamilton, Giordano, they're a little bit less. And with all of those contracts, you're saving probably about $500,000 on each. And because of that, it will help the team to build a contender as they will have that little bit of extra play, especially in like 2 or 3 seasons from now, to be able to get a full top nine forwards that are good, good top four, and two good goaltenders. So,
well, and if you listen to the interviews with Brad Treliving this week, that's exactly what you're going to hear. Is he said that, you know, everybody sort of had to think about the better of the team.
Yeah, and I think any of the players in the organization would rather lose a couple hundred grand and have a legitimate shot to win multiple Stanley Cups than earning the top max that they can and that impacting the ability for the Flames to do so.
I think it also shows that these players believe in this team. I mean, to take that, you know, to take any sort of a discount, especially over 6 years, tells you that these players believe this is a team that can get them, you know, a Stanley Cup ring.
Yeah, and how the team is built, especially with the addition of Matthew Tkachuk, you're starting to see a really good top nine set of forwards in the Flames right now, with a whole bunch of good quality prospects on the farm working their way up. So as the year progresses and into the next couple of seasons, you could see this team becoming the next Chicago or the next Los Angeles or whatever, and being one of those top teams that will compete for the Cup for the next few seasons.
And as we talked about in the past, once the Gaudreau deal was done, we said that we'd have a lot of contracts probably coming shortly after that. And any team, you know, like you're saying, if they're going to be Chicago, if they're going to be LA, you need that depth. You can't just have a top one or two lines. You need to have, you know, four rolling lines. And we've seen that with every successful team, four lines of good players. And we saw today the Flames helping to bolster their lineup all the way down. We saw the Flames signed Kris Versteeg to a one-year deal for $950,000, and he'll be wearing number 10 this season on his back. Matt, you were saying that there's a no-trade clause attached to this. I hadn't seen that, but what are the details around the no-trade clause?
Yeah, he can only not get dealt to three teams. So any
but we don't
other
know which three.
Yeah, so he's available to be dealt to 27 or 26 teams. There's three that he does not want to go to, which I can't blame him. There's obviously some teams where he just might have burned a bridge or didn't have a good experience because he's played on, I think, seven teams.
Or it's Edmonton.
Yeah, or Edmonton or Winnipeg. So we'll see. But for a one-year deal, you can't go wrong. You know, if he doesn't work out, oh well, then you just move on. So no risk and possible good reward. He had 38 points last season on two teams, and the Flames' lack of depth on the right wing should allow him to actually get an opportunity on the first line with Gaudreau and Monahan.
Well, if you look at it too, I mean, he was making $4.7 million last year, got 38 points. The year before, he got 34 points, and the year before that, 29. So, you know, anyone who can get kind of the 30 to 40 point range, if you can get that kind of production for less than $1 million, that's a fantastic deal. And I think that we're going to see this. I don't think that he's going to be the best player on the team by any stretch, but I think that we're going to look back at the Versteeg deal at the end of the year and say, wow, what a great value we got on that contract.
Yeah. And that was one of the things that I was concerned about going into the season, was the fact that Brouwer's worked so well with Bennett and Tkachuk, and Backlund and Frolik work so well together that you don't want to shift either Frolik or Brouwer onto the first line, because you're just robbing the good second and third lines by shifting one of those guys away. So having Versteeg on the first line will allow the natural chemistry with the other two lines to continue and allow the flexibility, because you know Gaudreau and Monahan are going to do their thing. I don't think it really matters who the third person is on that line. So Versteeg will likely just get a good opportunity to basically go stand in front of the net and let Gaudreau hit his stick, basically, with some good passes.
And, you know, I think that there's, you know, multiple ways to look at this. I think that this sort of brings in not a guy who's as old as Brouwer, but a good veteran player to play with those young guys. Just like the reason we brought Brouwer in is to give some veteran leadership on the second line. I think this gives some veteran leadership on the first line. He's a natural right winger and a right shot, which we don't have a lot of. I think that one of the most interesting things about Versteeg is going to be what kind of, like I said, what kind of numbers he puts up. I think that with Gaudreau and Monahan, he's never played a top role on a team. So with Gaudreau and Monahan, I wouldn't be surprised if he gets into the 40-point area this year. I don't think he'll be a sniper. I think he'll be a playmaker on that line, getting more assists. But if we can get him into the, you know, the 40-point range for $950,000, that's a fantastic deal.
Well, even if he has a really good season, like, it makes sense for him to come here on a one-year deal, because if he, say he has like a career year, gets 55, 60 points, which isn't out of the realm of possibility when playing with two guys of that caliber, like, he's setting himself up very well for next year to go and say, hey, I want a three-year, $5 million contract. Maybe he gets only four or three and a half from some other team. So, you know, it makes sense for him to take a haircut this year with the opportunity to play with those two guys and maybe cash in at the end of the year with some other team for a multi-year, well, $3-plus million contract instead.
I had a feeling the Flames were going to hire one of the tryout players when they sent Shinkarik down. I just had a feeling they were going to hire one of the tryouts. I thought it would have been Korpakovsky or Higgins, one of the two at our camp, but who would have known that we would have signed one of the guys trying out of the Oilers camp, Kris Versteeg. And the rumors that we're hearing out there are that the Oilers also offered him a deal, but it's believed that they were offering him a two-way deal and the Flames offered him a one-way, which is why he took that deal.
Yeah, well, he wasn't going to play all the time in Edmonton, where the Flames are basically like, here, we're going to put you with Monahan and Gaudreau, and like, you'd just be stupid not to do that.
And the other player the Flames signed out of their own training camp on a part-time tryout agreement was defenseman Nick Grossmann, who will wear number 8 this year for the Flames. He signed a one-year deal worth $575,000. No trade or anything coming in on that one, just a standard one-year, one-way deal at $575,000. This one I don't think is too surprising. I don't know about you, but we both said that Grossmann had a legit shot at getting signed out of camp.
Yeah, and if you look at the organization, they have a lot of good quality two-way defensemen. And so, like, if any of the five guys that play a two-way game get hurt, you've got guys like Kulak, Wotherspoon, Shillington, Anderson that can come up and play that type of a game. But if Englund gets hurt, there is, you know, you have to go to Keegan Kanzig as the only guy that plays that physical, tough, rugged style game. So, in effect, Nick Grossmann is replacing Ladislav Smead, who is hurt and out for the year, in terms of that
cheaper.
Yeah, and he plays that style of game. Now, is Grossmann the best player? No. He's a legitimate number 7 defenseman. You don't really want to see him playing that much. But he does bring physicality. As you saw in the preseason, he was hitting people left, right, and center. Got into a fight and protected the goaltender in that one game. He is what he is.
I think as a number 7, he's a great choice. He's a veteran guy. I don't want to see a young guy sitting out for most of the year. If Grossman's sitting in the press box, if he's scratched for most of the year, I think when you need him to fill in those, you know, 4 or 5 games at a time, he'll do just fine. He has enough NHL experience. He knows what's expected of him. He comes out of the Stars organization, so Gullinson knows him well, I would imagine. And, yeah, I don't want to see him playing, you know, 5-6 minutes, but as a 7 guy, I think he's perfectly capable.
Yeah, and as you said, you don't want to have a guy like Kulak or Wotherspoon sitting for most of the year. You want them playing if they're going to be here. So, Grossmann, if somebody's banged up for a game or two and he comes in, I don't see that being that big of a deal. And it's 1 year. If he doesn't play well, you can always just reassign him to Stockton. And I see no downside and not really a ton of upside either on this one.
I think that for most number 7s, though, there's not usually a lot of upside. There's kind of your fill-in guy, your guy who's there, and I think that Grossmann is looking at our defensive core, and we'll talk more about some of the guys maybe we missed out on later, but I think all things considered, of the defenseman available, Grossman's a good choice.
Yeah, and I know some people are going to be disappointed that the Flames didn't go out sign Claudel, but we had too much depth of that type of guy anyway, where Grossmann, we didn't have depth in that type of player. So, all in all, I have nothing to complain about with him getting signed.
So, two new Flames announced on opening day. I can't remember last time that happened, that on opening day we had two new contracts signed. One guy returning, which is Johnny Gaudreau. And then we also have all of the final cuts that were made. So the Flames have pared down to their opening day rosters. Since the last time you and I talked, Matt, I'll go through the list and then we can talk about if there's anybody here that surprises us. Brandon Boelig was waived, cleared waivers, and sent to the AHL. Kenny Morrison, Garnet Hathaway, David Rittich, Hunter Shinkarik, Tyler Watherspoon, Lyndon Vey, were all sent down to the AHL of Stockton. Dan Preble has been medically cleared to play. He's now officially on the AHL roster. And two players have already been reassigned from the AHL to the ECHL. Brett Pollock, who we brought in as part of the Jyrki Okupak acquisition for Kris Russell, and Mason McDonald have both been sent down to Adirondack of the ECHL. So any of these guys that got cut, Boelig, Morrison, Hathaway, Rittich, Shinkarik, Watherspoon, or Vey, surprise you?
Not in the slightest. And I'm actually glad that the Flames did do the tough thing and waived and reassigned Brandon Boelig. The game has just changed, simply. And the one-way type of guy that Boelig is, where he's just basically the designated fighter, that position simply is no longer in the NHL anymore, and it's just not necessary. You need to be able to play as well, and Boelig is simply the 18th or 19th best forward in the organization in terms of playing an NHL game, and you just simply can't have that. Like, even in the press box, you just...
He can always come back up if we need him.
Yeah, and... there's just too many better players, period. And I'd rather have a guy like Hathaway or Hamilton who can fight but can play instead of Boelig, who's not very good and is a decent fighter.
Well, I think that's a good point, too. I think that if you look at the role that Boelig was asked to play, Hathaway stepped into that role, sort of like we saw with Ferland and McGrattan a few years ago. Hathaway stepped into that role, and he's a better hockey player. And I think if we need muscle, Hathaway will get the call from Stockton. I think Bolig's there just to wait out his last year of his contract. I don't see Boelig coming back.
Neither do I.
If Boelig's back, something's gone wrong with our forward depth.
Yeah, and I think if that's the case, then I think the Flames have four or five injuries.
The day Boelig comes back is the day we kiss our playoff berth a goodbye.
Probably not, but like if the Flames ran into a bunch of injury trouble, then I could see, because Boelig can at least play fourth line minutes.
Yeah, but I think you could pull up a lot of guys from Stockton who could play fourth line minutes.
True.
I mean, you got guys like Poirier, you got guys like Shinkarik. There's a lot of guys there that could at least carry fourth line minutes for, you know, 10 games.
True. That's why, like, if it's like four or five injuries up front, then I could see Boelig getting the recall, but as you said, like Shinkarik, Jankowski, Poirier, Hathaway, like all those guys would likely get called up first. And
just looking at the depth in Stockton, I wouldn't be surprised if we see Boelig end up in the ECHL this year.
That's possible too.
We just have a lot of forwards in Stockton, and I don't see where Boelig fits in there, so I wouldn't be surprised if they reassign him to the E.
Could very well happen.
I was hoping Hunter Shinkarik would make the roster. When he got sent down, like I said earlier, I kind of expected that was a sign they were signing a more veteran player to play wing. I don't think by any means this is the end of Hunter Shinkarik this season. I think it's just that, you know what, he's probably going to play more minutes at the beginning being in the AHL than playing fourth line minutes in the NHL. Because if you look right now, there's no room for him. So good move, and I think Shinkarik will be one of the first call-ups.
Well, one of the things that Brad Treliving was saying today that I agree with wholeheartedly is that nobody stepped up to take one of those spots. And everybody was given an opportunity, but even a guy like Shinkarik or Jankowski, they played well. Like, in a pinch, you could throw them in the NHL lineup, but there was nobody
there. They looked call-up ready.
Yeah, but they didn't just go this spot's mine. I'm taking it and too effing bad.
Yeah, they look like they're ready to play 10 games, not 82 of them.
Exactly. And that's where, like, they just need a little bit more time in Stockton. Play on the first line, like Jankowski in the first preseason game for Stockton got a hat trick. So, like, there's talent there. It's just you need more consistency and a higher level of play from all of the Stockton players, and they didn't show it enough consistently during the preseason to take a spot.
But I think if you look at this roster, both up front and on the back end, there's room for guys to be usurped. Just like we saw a few years ago in Hartley's first year here, there's room for somebody to take a job. And if these guys can play well in Stockton, I think they could easily earn themselves a job. It's not like we've got, you know, 14 forwards all locked up to one-way deals that there's no job to take.
Yeah. And, like, if you look at the fourth line with a guy like Matt Stajan, it is possible for a player to beat him out for a spot on the lineup. So we just have to wait and see how they play in Stockton this year and see how the Flames lineup looks at the end of the month and see if any adjustments need to be made.
Talking about players that have come and players that have been cut, there's a few opportunities the Flames have missed out on. Some former Flames who we thought could potentially come here. And for both these guys, I think it might just be simply timing of these guys wanting to get a deal done early, and it seemed like the Flames were waiting for the Gaudreau deal. But Jakub Nykladl, who we've talked about potentially coming back, signed a one-year deal in Carolina with the Hurricanes. I think that's a good pickup for the Canes. And Kris Russell, former Flames defenseman, who we were talking last week about the rumors they might come back to Calgary. Seems like, again, he wanted to get a deal done and he signed with Edmonton. I told you right from the get-go back in July, I can see Russell as an Oiler. It made sense to me. And I'd like to see him back here, but it makes sense for him to go to Edmonton.
Can't argue there. He'll get a good opportunity there. Likely next season he'll sign another decent contract. I think he was asking for too much when he went to free agency, but we'll see. And I'm glad that Nykladl got an NHL contract. I spoke to him, and you spoke to him last year, and spoke to him again in the preseason last year, and seemed like a decent guy. And you want to see people that are decent actually being successful, so good for him getting a contract. I'm sure he'll
have a good
year.
Well, I think he earned it. I mean, he was sort of the dark horse last year to get called up. He got called up. He played great. I think that he earned himself an NHL deal. Unfortunately for him, it wasn't in Calgary. That doesn't necessarily mean he'll never be back in Calgary. But to me, I think for both these guys, they were probably waiting. I think Calgary probably said, we want to bring them both back. We got to wait on the Johnny thing. And they just wanted to get a deal done to know they were going to have a home for the year.
Yeah, and I wouldn't expect either of these players to be back just due to the likely development of some of our prospects, whether it's Kulak or Shillington or Anderson or even...
I don't think you'll see him back maybe next year, but I could see Nykladl coming in a few years as sort of your number seven guy.
Yeah, that's a possibility. But, so good for them for getting jobs. And hopefully they have good seasons with their respective teams to earn additional contracts down the road.
And as is the time of year, it's waiver season. This is the only time of year we really see massive amounts of guys going on waivers. The Flames use the waivers themselves for Lyndon Vay and Brandon Bolig. But Matt, there's a number of guys in waivers you were hoping the Flames would take a shot at. Who is that?
There was four right-wing prospects that were waived. Timu Pulkkinen, Stanislav Galiev, Martin Furk, and Seth Griffith. And the Flames opted not to claim any of them. They didn't have the opportunity to get Griffith as he was claimed by Toronto. With the Flames' lack of organizational depth on right wing, I thought that they might have had an opportunity to get one of those guys. Might have been a decent option for the team somewhere, but the signing of Versteeg basically helped to cancel that out.
Yeah, I think the team probably knew that they were going to sign. My guess is they knew for a while the Versteeg thing was in the works. They just had to get Johnny signed first, because it kind of seems like everything was leading towards that, with Shinkara going down, not picking these guys up. I knew something was afoot.
Yeah.
And we do have the room if we did want to pick them up. The Flames currently sit at 44 of their total of 50 pro contracts, so if they would have had the room to do it.
And I'm sure that the two former Red Wings, Firk and Pulkkinen, will get a quality opportunity in Carolina and I think Minnesota to show whether they're good quality top six forwards or not. So that's the one problem when you have an organization like Detroit. You have too many good players, and some you just have to give away, even though they're quality prospects.
And, you know, I always find the teams that, you know, give up a quality prospect like that somewhere on waivers, it generally comes back in their favor somewhere else. Either with, you know, you'll often see those teams get a good deal in a future considerations trade or something like that down the road. So I find it always comes back to be in their favor somehow. Well, Matt, are you ready to look at the opening day rosters?
I think that'd be a good idea.
The Calgary Flames have announced their 2016-2017 opening day roster. Remember, this doesn't mean these are the guys that are going to be here all year. These are just the guys that we submitted to league headquarters to open the season. So let's start on the forwards. We'll do these numerically. First one on the list is number 10, the newcomer Kris Versteeg, listed as a right winger. Some familiar faces in number 11, Michael Backlund, a centerman, and number 13, Johnny Gaudreau, the left winger. Number 17, Lance Boma, a left winger. Number 18, Matthew Stajan, a centerman. Another newcomer, number 19, Matthew Tkachuk, listed as a left winger. 23 is Sean Monahan, a center. Another newcomer, at least new this year to making the opening day rosters, Freddie Hamilton, center. Number 36, Troy Brower, right wing. Number 39, Alex Chiasson, right wing. Number 67, Michael Frolik, right wing. Number 79, Michael Ferland, left wing. Number 93, Sam Bennett, left wing and center. On the back end, we have number 3, Jyrki Joki-Paka. Number 5, the captain, Mark Giordano. Number 6, Dennis Wideman. Number 7, TJ Brody. Number 8, Nicklas Grossmann. Number 27, Dougie Hamilton. Number 29, Derek England. And number 61, Brett Kulak, who also made last year's opening day roster. In net, two brand new faces. Number 1 is going to be Brian Elliott, the veteran, and number 31, Chad Johnson, is his backup. When you look at this list, Matt, first impressions.
I think this is a playoff team and a good up-and-coming team. I like the depth on all of the top three lines. I'm expecting Lance Boma to play with Backlund and Frolik. So, like, if you look at the first three lines, you got Gaudreau, Monahan, Versteeg, decent.
So that's what you do for your first line is Gaudreau, Monahan, Versteeg?
Yeah.
I had the same written down in my notes. And I think, I mean, like, we were talking a few weeks ago about who's going to play right. And while I don't think he's necessarily a bona fide top line right winger, I think Versteeg's the best option we've got.
Yeah, like realistically, he's more of a second, third line right wing, but you don't want to break Brower and Bennett up or Backlund and Frolik. So you're kind of stuck, and he can easily play with those two guys up front. So,
and I think the Versteeg could elevate his game and really make something out of this.
Exactly.
I think he might be one of these guys that's just played on good teams and never had the chance to really rise to the occasion, and this year will tell us if that's right or not.
Yeah, and you can always make adjustments down the road. Like, if certain players struggle, you can try different things out. I'm not expecting this set of lines to stay 100% consistent all year. You know how it goes. Like, if you're struggling, you always switch things up and see if you can't get players going. So, for the opening day, that's what I'd expect.
I think we both have a consensus as well on the second forward line. I think it'll be Tkachuk, Bennett, and Brower.
Yeah, they were fun in the preseason, so I'm expecting that fun to continue, at least for the first 9 games. But I think Tkachuk's going to stay here all year, so.
Well, looking at the roster, we kind of need him to stay here. There's really nobody besides Shin Carrick that slots into that spot. I think that it's Tkachuk's spot to lose at this point.
Yeah, you know, I think you'd have to have a disastrous 9 games, which from how he played in the preseason, I just simply don't see that. He's too good for the OHL. He had over 100 points last year in the OHL. Like, what's he going to do down there?
And he's also got good chemistry already with his line mates, which I think will help his case in staying.
Yeah, and all three of the players have that same pesty attitude. So what better way to have him break into the NHL than be playing with guys that are basically like him and can all three of them can work together to piss the other teams off. I like the makeup of that line, and I'm hoping that that sticks all year.
Yeah, I think that's probably a line that, and I think we might see quite a bit of offensive production from that line. I think we've got a nice 1-2 combo going on.
Same here.
If we look at the third line, I think we're also in consensus on the third line. It'll probably be Lance Boma on the left wing, Michael Frolik on the right wing, with Michael Backlund centering that line.
Yep, and the only possible change would be Michael Furland and going with the all-Michael line. That would be the only possible switch I'd make on that line.
I think for opening day, at least, just because of what Boma's making, you put him on line three, I think that'll be his spot to lose.
Yeah, see if he can't rekindle some of that 16-goal magic from a couple years ago. And as you said, if he struggles, Furland's there to try out, so we'll see.
So our final line, the fourth line, this is probably going to be our line. I'm pegging the fourth line as Furland, Hamilton, Chiasson.
Yeah, I could see that. And if you need a more veteran guy, you can always throw Stajan on any of those spots.
I just don't see the point in keeping Hamilton on the big roster. Just have him sit and watch.
I agree. I thought he played better than Stajan consistently in each game.
Stajan looked terrible in the preseason.
Yeah. Honestly, Stajan's only there to be the press box guy like Grossmann, I think.
I think it might be a bit of a motivator for Stajan. Stajan hasn't really been taken out of the lineup yet. So I think if Freddie comes in and they say, you know what, you're taking the fourth line, Matt, you got to beat Freddie. I'm hoping it might ignite Matt Stajan to play better. But if not, he's going to be an expensive press box addition.
Yeah. Well, I think Stajan, much like Mason Raymond last year, if he doesn't put up quality play, period, then I think he's going to be relegated to the press box, maybe move to Stockton later in the season. Like, especially if a guy like Jankowski plays exceptionally well in Stockton and moves up into the NHL, I think you'll see Stajan get sent down and probably bought out if he does not play up to any expectations.
Yeah, I don't know if I can't see him getting. I think you wait until at least after the expansion draft to buy him out, because you never know what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I can't see Stajan staying here all year. I think that, unlike Mason Raymond, they're not going to give him as much rope as they did Raymond last year. I honestly don't see Stajan being in Calgary by Christmas. I think it's going to be put up or pack up and get to Stockton.
I agree.
I think that putting Stajan as the extra center, I mean, we've never had. I can't remember the last time we've looked at Stajan and said, wow, this guy looks even like a fourth or third line centerman in the NHL. He's just there. And I don't see what he's done this year to earn a spot. And I think looking at Hamilton in the preseason, he's done some to earn a spot. So I would make Stajan fight back in the lineup if I was the coach.
Yep, I agree. And I think when the Flames re-sign Stajan, I don't think that they were expecting the team to be as good as fast as it has come together. Like, having the four-year contract, it was like the fourth year was going to be the year where the Flames were going to turn it around. But the Flames were really good two seasons ago, partially as good last year. And like this year, we're looking at more of a contender style build to the team. I just don't think that the Flames expected to be at this point already. And Stajan just simply is not good enough for that.
Fun fact, Stajan is the last vestige of the Dion Phaneuf trade.
Yeah, and has been for a while.
And if you look at someone like Versteeg, I think Stajan will probably take a similar thing when his contract's done. I think he's going to make a lot of money these next 2 years, not play a whole lot. Then I think he'll probably end up taking somebody's, PTO and maybe getting signed for less than $1 million after that. I don't think Stajan's going to be making $3 million plus ever again in his career.
I actually think that this is Stajan's last NHL contract, so I don't even think he'll get signed after this. I think
you think that he'll be a Glenn Cross?
Yeah, it's either going to have to go over to Europe or retire after this. I just simply don't see anybody. Like, he's just not an NHL player at this point. And that's not to say anything bad about Stajan the person. Like, he's a good guy, but, it's a business, and unfortunately, you have to put your best players out there, and simply he is not playing.
And that's one of the reasons I think the Flames might keep him around a bit longer, is he's a great community guy. And I think they might keep him around just to do a lot of the stuff he does with the Children's Hospital and Ronald McDonald House and all these things that he and his wife do in the community. There's nothing necessarily wrong with that, but I think that Stockton could use that as well. I think he'd be a great veteran sort of captain down in Stockton. And I think it's a reason Vegas might want him too, is to kickstart some of that. But I think at least this year, Stajan's going to have to play his way back in the lineup. I'm honestly surprised he's in the opening day lineup, but I don't think he'll be a Flame come January 1.
Can't argue with you.
I guess time will tell. If we see his jersey on sale at Fanatic, it probably means he's going down. Do they even sell number 18 jerseys as it is to put on sale?
I'm not sure.
I don't know anyone that's bought one. So we looked at the forwards. Let's look at the pairings on the blue line. I think undisputed first line pairing is Gio Brody.
Well, apparently the coach is going to try Gio Weidman. He is splitting Giordano and Brody to start the year. I don't think that'll last very long, but...
it's a new coach. He probably just wants to see what he's got. I'm surprised he picked Weidman of all people. That's not really your first-line defenseman.
No. And for some reason, he's wanting to try Brody as a left guy on the defense, which every time I've seen him playing on the left side, he just simply has not looked comfortable there. And, like, all through the preseason when he was playing on the left side, like, he just looked out of place there. Like, even though he's a left-shooting defenseman, he just simply doesn't work well there. Which makes sense when you've played that many years on the right side. You get used to playing in that manner. So, I don't know if that experiment will last more than a period or two, but we'll see.
So if we look at what we think will be sort of the long-term pairings, I think Gio Brody's number one.
Yeah.
Yoki Paakkanen-Hamilton number two.
Probably. Although then, it could be Brody with Hamilton if they want to keep Brody on the left side.
I think that Gio and Brody have so much magic, you'd be foolish to break that up long-term. You might try it for a few games at the beginning against Edmonton, but all year I think Brody, Gio... they're a team. They're like Batman and Robin. You can't have Batman, you know, Robin and Superman and Batman and somebody else. It's Batman and Robin. It's Gio and Brody.
Yep. I'm not arguing with you.
And then what's your third pairing? Is it, I mean, we've kind of got, if I look at this, we've got four defensemen left. Weidman, Kulak, Grossmann, England. I think that just based on who's left, I think Weidman, England becomes the third pairing.
Yeah. It depends. Like, I don't see the Flames carrying eight defensemen for more than a week or two.
No, it's weird that we're carrying an extra pair of defensemen.
Yeah, and I think the reason for that is that maybe there is something in the works where the Flames are looking at trading a defenseman, because realistically, the Flames do have eight NHL defensemen right now. Like, they are NHL caliber guys. So, if the... there are some teams out there that don't have the defensive depth that the Flames do, so I could see the Flames dealing a guy like Weidman outright, in which case Kulak would take his spot in the lineup, and I think that's part of the reason why Kulak is here. So, we'll see. If you had England and Kulak as the third pairing, that'd be fine. And again, if you have Weidman in Kulak's spot, that's fine too. So
I think until this gets sorted out, Weidman, England becomes our third pairing, and I think Kulak, Grossmann will be probably riding the press box.
Yep, I agree.
If Treliving could successfully sign Giordano and move the Weidman contract in 1 week, I think this guy deserves like a bronze statue outside of the new arena.
Well, he's been doing a good job lately, so... we'll
he's
see.
Able to sign good contracts, but he can't get rid of bad contracts. His magic only goes so far.
Well, there's only so many teams out there, and they each have their stinker contracts, so...
this is where you got to call up Edmonton and be like, hey, you know who looked really good with Russell? Weidman.
Yeah, they had a lot of magic together. Too bad that they traded Yakupov. That would have been a perfect trade.
You got to have them both. If we got Gio Brody, you guys need to have Russell Weidman.
Yeah, they were great in the playoffs together 2 years ago. So,
And, I mean, you were talking about Kulak. Kulak started the season here last year, and he got sent down, and he was never really brought back up. So I think that you can only do this so many times. I agree with you. I think that with eight defensemen on the opening day roster, something's got to give. It's not going to be – nobody's going to get sent down at this point. I think Kulak, if he goes down, he has to clear waivers. He might get claimed.
No, he doesn't.
Okay, so if he doesn't need to clear waivers, then – maybe you send him down, but it's kind of a tease to bring him up again and then send him down after, what, 3 weeks last time?
Yeah. Well, so I think he did improve, and I think he was the highest point getter amongst the defensemen in preseason. He's not a great player, but there's potential there for him to develop into something more than a filler guy. So we'll see. I'm hoping that if he is up, he actually does play a couple of games just to see where he's at in the NHL and see how he goes. Because you got to remember that the old guard of Culkin, Kulak, and Wotherspoon, they're getting a lot of pressure from the next group of Shillington, Anderson, and Hickey. So they have
to put up or move on.
So
yeah. Matt, I want to run something by you. We were talking last week about Weidman and trying to move that contract. And I mean, $5.2 million is a lot of money to move, and I can't see ownership wanting to bury $5 million in the farm. But if we have to bury a contract, what would you think if the Flames buried England's contract?
I don't see there being a reason for that, really.
I don't know. I think England, to me, has always sort of been a number seven. If he's playing 6 minutes and you want to get a guy like Kulak into the roster, you might send England down. $3 million is easier to stomach down there than 5.2.
Well, the thing is that the Flames, they don't have that type of guy in the organization that's NHL ready. And I know England and Grossmann, they're not great overall defensemen, but they bring that physical game, and the Flames just simply don't have anybody. Like, Keegan Kanzig is the only guy in the organization that's even relatively close to playing in the NHL that plays that style of game. And England, he's a number six, number seven guy. He was that when we signed him, and he'll be a solid defensive defenseman that, like, if you need some physicality, he'll bring it, just like Grossmann. So I would sooner, even though it would really not be preferential, I would rather the Flames assign Weidman, even though it's a $5+ million contract to Stockton.
Well, so I'm just saying that with Grossmann, it might make England more expendable.
England's the better player, though, so...
Yeah, but at a if he's playing seven, though, yeah, I guess you'd rather keep the $3 million up and sit it than the $3 million in the farm and play it. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, I just simply don't see. Like, if we're going to get rid of any of the eight players, Weidman is the.
We have to remember that Weidman has a no movement clause.
Yeah, true. But, you know, you can also say, well, you're going to be in the press box, or you can go play with somebody else. And any player would rather be playing than in the press box. So
yeah, right now, if I look at this defensive core, though, I don't see Weidman sitting. I think we need him at least on the third line.
Yeah. Honestly, I'm kind of torn between him and Kulak, because Weidman did not play that well in preseason. So, like, if I'm going with the best possible lineup, I would actually slot Kulak in over Weidman at this
Kulak
point.
Kulak in England as your third pair?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, it's disappointing because, you know, he is being paid $5 million. And, like, that's not to say that Weidman's bad. Like, if he was playing his regular minutes and playing on the power play and all that, he would be a 30-plus, 40-point player. But when you have Giordano, you have Brody, you have Hamilton, and, say, Kulak in the lineup, you know, there's four guys that all can shoot the puck really well and are good quality power play options. Weidman needs to play in the top pairing on the power play in order to get 40-plus points, and the Flames just have better options at this point. So a team that needs an offensive defenseman, Weidman is a good option. I think
he's an expensive option.
Yeah, but I'm sure that the Flames could find a way to either eat some of his contract or take a not-so-good contract back. So,
I think Weidman will be moved. I don't think it happens anytime soon, though. I think if it happens closer to or at the deadline.
That's also a possibility. But I think if that's the case, then I think Kulak gets reassigned just to get him playing instead. But
They'll probably rotate Kulak and Weidman out in the first little bit, see who the better one is. And yeah, if Kulak loses the job, then they'll definitely reassign him.
Yeah. It'll be interesting, regardless, to see that battle and see who's the winner of it at the end.
So, Matt, looking at this roster, who do you think the first guy to lose his spot, his full-time job, is?
Well, we were literally just talking about him, Dennis Weidman.
You think Weidman?
Yep.
I think it's going to be Stajan.
Well, I think Stajan's already lost his job, so I think Hamilton's already taken his spot, so...
Yeah, but he's still got an NHL... I mean, he's still with the NHL team.
Yeah.
So I guess by losing their job, I mean get sent to Stockton or get shipped out.
Oh, well then, yeah, Stajan would be in that case.
Who do you think becomes the first call-up this year?
Jankowski. If you're talking Stajan Jankowski, if you're talking on the defensive line, I would have to say, like, because Kulak's already here, I'd say Shillington would be my first call-up.
See, I think it'll be Jankowski for forwards, and I think it'll be Wotherspoon for defensemen, just because I think the Flames have to decide what to do with this guy, and giving him short spurts might help them make that evaluation.
I'm going to have to disagree with you there. I think Wotherspoon's pretty much done in this organization, and he... During the preseason, one of the things that I noticed was that he is not improved at all when turning. So, like, say when the other player shoots the puck in, when he goes to turn, he's really poor in that aspect. And he was getting beat regularly. And you need a defenseman to be able to play defense at least adequately. And I just don't think that Wotherspoon's up to it, and I'd rather give Shillington the experience, for me anyway.
I think Shillington makes it, I just don't know if he becomes our first call-up.
Yeah. I know, like, I could see Wotherspoon being included in a trade at some point this year, I don't think he's going to be here for very much longer.
I understand what you're saying about Wotherspoon. I don't know if he'll be here that long. We do need some veteran defensive guys in the A, and I think that Wotherspoon could be that guy, but I think this is his last year. I think this year, if he doesn't do what he needs to do to earn an NHL spot, I think they have to move on from him. I think they'll give him the opportunity to do that this year. I mean, they've been calling him up every year and giving him some time to play, but I just think that he's on his last legs. And I think Shillington definitely get called up. I'm just not sure he's your kind of first call-up guy this year if you have an injury or something like that. I think he's going to be more effective playing in the AHL and getting first-line minutes down there.
It also depends on which guy gets hurt as well. Like, if England gets hurt, then you maybe go with a guy like Wotherspoon instead.
Well, I think if England gets hurt, you slot Grossmann in.
Yeah, I know. But to be called up, you'd probably go with a guy like Wotherspoon. Whereas if Giroux, Brody, or Hamilton gets hurt, then I would assume Shillington would get called up just for his offensive abilities.
Could be. Looking at this roster overall, what do you think the final position in the West is going to be for the Flames?
Well, for our division, I think we're going to be in a dogfight with Anaheim for first in the division all year. And I think that the Flames are going to be a 100-point team this year. Overall, I think probably fourth or fifth in the conference. And, like, right there in the upper part all season. And I could see the Flames actually surprising and going to the conference finals this year.
See, then they're going to go deep.
Yep.
I've said for a while, and I still stand by it, I think it's plausible we make the playoffs. I don't think this team is built to go deep. I think there's still some glaring holes in the roster, But I think that with the new coach and some of the fixes that we've put in, like Versteeg, and if we can make some deals to get rid of guys like Weidman and fill some of those holes, it's feasible this team could go into the playoffs. Every time the Flames made the playoffs lately, they've had good luck. I mean, we all remember 04. We remember the last run. So it's feasible they could do it again, I think. The core of the roster is the same. I'm going to predict that we end up 6th or 7th in the West. I don't think we're going to be as high as you think we're going to be. And I think this team's going to surprise. I don't think they're built for the playoffs, but I think they're going to make it in. I don't think it's a long-term playoff team, but I think they can make it this year.
Yeah. Well, you also have to factor the division that we're in. Like, Anaheim is not as strong as they were last year. San Jose, you know, just never know what you're going to get year to year from them. Like, 2 years ago, they missed the playoffs. Last year, they make the Stanley Cup Finals. And they didn't really change anything other than Martin Jones. It's hard to tell exactly what they're going to do.
I think San Jose is going to be a tough team to beat this year.
I think they're the most bubble of teams on the playoffs, actually. Because I am expecting some regression from Marlowe and Thornton. So, we'll see. And LA, they took a big step back, and I think I'd actually wouldn't be shocked if they missed the playoffs entirely.
I think, though, that Phoenix is looking good, and I think they could swap with LA.
Yeah. So, I think the top four in the division are going to be us, Anaheim, Arizona, and San Jose. Just not really sure which spots each of those teams. Like, I think Arizona's going to be fourth, regardless. It's what order the top three teams is going to be.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that, and I think that that might be the reason we get in this year is because it's a poor division. But if we had a strong division, I don't think there's a playoff-ready team. I don't think it's built, you know, for a Stanley Cup run yet as much as every year we want that. I think there's still probably a year or two left in a rebuild to get this team where we need it. I'm not saying we can't make the playoffs. I think we might get lucky, but...
Yeah, well, the thing is that with so many bad contracts that are ending soon that the Flames are going to be able to reassign those dollars to higher end players. So,
well, that's why I think we need to at least a couple more years.
Well, I think next year for sure we're in contender mode and like a legitimate Stanley Cup contender if they go out and sign a high end right winger. So, we'll see. Like, as anything, like, things can change over the course of a year or two, but I think this team is going to be like Chicago when they first got into the playoffs, and, like, they'll be a very tough team to actually knock out, especially with the caliber of goaltending we have, that it's going to be a lot better team overall. I wouldn't say that like the Flames are going to win the cup or be a viable top-tier contender, but if that did happen and the Flames found themselves in the Stanley Cup Finals, I wouldn't be surprised either. It would be more luck than overall ability, though, in that case.
I feel better with a guy like Versteeg in the lineup on the first line. I feel better with a guy like Grossmann being around. I think that the fact that they're filling some of those holes with veterans.
That are good veterans as well.
Yeah, at least serviceable veterans who are around. Instead of just saying, who's the next two young guys in line? I think that really shows the Flames also think that this might be the year that they need those veterans, that they need that to... you know, to make a go of this.
Yeah, because, like, if you were penciling in Shinkarik and, say, Kulak in those spots, like, that's just not quite as comfortable as Versteeg and Grossmann. So, we'll see. But, like, anything can happen. Like, Gaudreau could get hurt tomorrow and miss most of the season, in which case we're looking at another lottery pick. So, you know, things can happen, of course, but based on paper, this team should be a real pain for any other team to beat on any given night.
So in order for us to become a top tier team, and you know, as you're talking about one of those elite pinnacle teams, if you look at the last year's eventual Stanley Cup winning champions, they had only four players who were 20 plus goal scorers in Crosby, Kessel, Malkin, and Hornquist. How many 20-plus goal scorers and who do you think Calgary will have this year?
I think for 20-plus goal scorers, you got Gaudreau, Monahan, Bennett, and Brouwer.
I'm going to agree with those. I'll throw Giordano in, too.
Yeah, I could see it being close. I'm not it'll be in the 15-plus range for him.
I think Backlund and Frohley could be in the conversation, but I think the way that they're going to be played by Gullitzen is to be more defensive-minded, which I think will soften those numbers a little bit.
Yeah, I'm kind of penciling them in the 15 to 18 range myself.
But even if you're getting that kind of production, I mean, if you look at the first line then as being Gaudreau, Monahan, Versteeg, the second line of Tkachuk, Bennett, Brouwer, the third line of Boma, Backlund, Frolik, and you're getting 18 goals from Backlund, Frolik, that's still pretty good third line production.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And, like, I think you could pencil Versteeg and Tkachuk in that 15 to 20 goal range as well.
So, I mean, if we go by those numbers, if last year's Stanley Cup champions had four guys that are, you know, in the 20-goal range, and we've got four, maybe five, I think that that's, you know, we are showing that we have that kind of offensive muscle that it probably takes.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames were one of the top offensive teams in the NHL last season, and we
just
we
let too many
improved.
Pucks in.
Yeah, like, we were the worst team for goaltending in the NHL. We gave up the most goals, period, and now that has tightened up, plus the change in the defensive system entirely. You could see it in the preseason. We were a very much more defensive-minded team, and I expect that the amount of goals against to drop probably by about 50 to 60, just based off of those two things. So if the Flames have a top 10 offense and, say, a 10-ish to 15th in goals against, like, this team's going to be a really tough team to play against.
Talking about their being a team to play against and their style, I was asked a lot over the Thanksgiving weekend, so what's going to be different this year with the on-ice product? And it really made me sit down and analyze what we saw from Hartley and what I expect from Gullitzen based on the preseason. Tell me what you think of these, man. If you think about Hartley, he was really big on the collapsing defense. He was really big on clogging up the areas in front of the attackers. I don't think we're going to see a lot of that anymore. I think that we're going to see active high-pressure defense and a lot of proactive play, not just clogging up passing lanes and shooting lanes. I think that we're going to see a lot more challenging of those players. I think we're going to see a lot of guys, you know, maybe playing out of position a little bit, trying to get right in somebody's face.
Yeah, and one of the main changes is not surrendering the blue line. And that was one of the things that drove me nuts about Hartley's system. The Flames' defense, other than Weidman and maybe Englund, they're very fast as defensemen. So if you stop them at the blue line and they have to chip it in, there's a very good chance that the defender, whether it's Gaudreau, Brody, or Hamilton, is going to get back and get the puck and be able to get it out before they can even do anything with it. So just that in and of itself will be a major change, instead of surrendering the blue line and allowing the other team to do what they have to do. And one of the things,
I think another thing on that same point is the stretch passes too. All the time in Hartley's system, the guys are making these long stretch passes.
And I could devise a system that would stop that in, like, 5 minutes. That was a very preventable way. Like, you just have to get your sticks in the passing lanes, and then you can shut the Flames' whole offensive system right down. So, and that
the
was
stretch pass is a good tool, don't get me wrong, when used correctly.
Yeah,
but you can't use it every time you want to move the puck into the offensive zone.
Yeah, because, like, the one game that we went to after Christmas together last year against Anaheim, that's all they were doing is just getting their sticks in the passing lane. The Flames had zero scoring chances in the entire game.
Because Anaheim just took it away.
Yeah, and, like, any team, like, if you're just doing the same thing all game, you can adapt to that and just shut it down. And if there's no flexibility of, okay, this isn't working, let's do this instead. And I think that's part of the reason why Hartley's no longer the coach, is that lack of flexibility. If this isn't going, do this instead. There wasn't any of that. And as you said, the stretch pass is a good tool, but if that's your only tool, that's not a good thing.
It's like diving for the puck. It's a good tool when needed, but it can't be our only tool.
Yeah, same with blocking shots last year. That was our main defensive thing of just, you know, having everybody block as many shots as possible. Well, if you're doing that solely, then there's something wrong with your system. And, well, the Flames gave up the most goals in the NHL last year, so that's kind of indicative of it.
Based on what we saw in the preseason, I think we're also going to see a lot of short passes. I think it's going to be a very short passing system. You'll be seeing a lot more passes to get it out, but it just gives you more flexibility as a forward unit of what you want to do.
Yeah, and the Flames are built now as a puck control team, and we saw that in the preseason where the Flames outshot the opposition heavily each game. And like even the games that we lost, we outshot them heavily. And like that's a good thing, especially for advanced statistics people who like Corsi and all that. That's a positive thing. It's just now that we've got Gaudreau and Monahan in the lineup, that'll hopefully improve in terms of goal production, because that was lacking throughout the preseason.
And I think that puck, you know, puck possession and puck recovery too is a big thing, especially on the PK and the PP we're going to have to see. On the PK, we have to get better down low recovery. We have to be able to recover that puck in our own zone and hold on to it. Not pass out front of the net, but be able to control it better. And same thing on the PK, on the PP. I think that we need, when it's shot in, we need to be able to control it and get it out quickly. And you saw a lot of times the Flames just kind of play with the puck in their own end and kill all their power play time.
Yeah, and one of the things, changes that I noticed quite significantly was the protection of the home plate area, which is the area right in front of the goaltender. And you would see that the Flames were more willing to give up shots from the point and the half wall.
To prevent them right in front.
Yeah, and like if you look at statistically, goalies will stop like 97% of those shots. It's the ones that are like right in that home plate area in front of the net that are the danger areas where you'd give up a lot of goals. And last year, the Flames gave up a ton of shots in that area, which contributed to the bad goals against. So if the Flames can limit those shots by having all of five of the players basically in that area, if the point shot does get through and a rebound is there, you've got five guys to clear it out and not allow the secondary shots from in close. And that's one of the important things that I saw during the preseason, was limiting those high quality shots from those areas.
Yeah, so I think it'll be a definitely noticeable. I mean, since you change coaches, they're not much noticeable, but I think it's definitely going to be a noticeable change from Bob Hartley to Glenn Gullitson. I think it's going to look like a very different team in the way they play hockey.
Yeah, and going from more of an Edmonton Oilers-themed team, run-and-gun offense from Hartley to a more Chicago-slash-St. Louis type of overall two-way defensive play. So which that's important, because usually the good teams that go on to reach the Stanley Cup Finals play more of the style that we've seen during the preseason.
I think under Hartley too, the lines didn't have much different identity. It was different numbers on the ice, but they all played the same way. And just looking at the lineup, the way that we've written it out, I see every line having a very different style of play and all having to achieve different things. Now, our first line is obviously going to be out there trying to put that puck on the net as many times as possible. In the second line, the Tkachuk, Bennett, Brower, going to be doing the same, but I see a lot more passing around that line. I don't think you're going to necessarily have one sniper.
Yeah, and all three of them are physical guys that are willing to crash the net as well, where Gaudreau and Monahan obviously are more finesse guys.
Yeah, Gaudreau and Monahan are going to go for the big finesse shot, you know, from both the hash marks. I think that the Brower, Bennett, Tkachuk line, they're going to be right in front. They're going to be causing traffic, screening a lot. They're going to be your sort of nitty gritty in, you know, right in front line.
Yeah, crash and bang with goals. So
I think that the Boma, Backlund, Frolik line is going to be your big two-way line. I think there's going to be some offensive power there, but I think really they're going to be looked at as sort of just kind of being that two-way line. shutdown line to go against the first line of other teams.
Yeah, exactly. And all three are good Corsi players, so you're going to want them to be out, and good puck control guys, so you're going to want them out against the other team's good lines to shut them down.
Yeah, and the fourth line is our usual crash and bang line. So I think that this year you're going to be able to distinctly tell a difference in play style based on which line's on the ice.
Yeah, and I like the fact that the Flames have two good quality crash and bang lines as well, because the Flames need to be able to intimidate the other teams. And one of the things that Brian Burke has said is truculence for years, but good teams always, especially in the postseason, like if you go from 2007 with Anaheim, the eventual Stanley Cup champions were always the physical team, except for the three seasons where two finesse teams faced off against each other. When Detroit played Pittsburgh twice, and then last season it was two finesse teams. But every other year, when you had a physical team going up against a non-physical team, the physical team won. So, and sometimes, like when Chicago and Boston played, they were two physical teams, and that was, you know, fun to watch. But, you know, building a type of team that will actually win the Stanley Cup, you need that kind of crash and bang throughout the lineup, and having two lines that, like, that's their instinctive way of playing is a good thing.
Yeah, it is, and I think that it really kind of lets guys know too, okay, you're called up from the farm due to injury or whatever, you're on the third line. This is the type of guy we're calling up. It's not just the who's the best, it's really the who fits on this line, and I think that's important for the team identity.
Yeah, because, like, say one of the bottom line guys gets hurt, well, a guy like Garnett Hathaway, who plays that same style of crash and bang, would be more suited to play in that spot, where you wouldn't necessarily want Shinkarak or Poirier doing that, because that's not really 100% of their game. So
yeah, and I think in the past we've sometimes just had it where it's like, okay, you're the next best guy, come on up.
Yeah, but now we've got identities for every line, so.
Well, and that's why I think you might see a wider variety, almost like the first year Hartley was here. We saw a wider variety of players brought up because they were all brought up to fill different roles.
Yep, I agree.
I'm going to make one more prediction. I think in order to be really successful this year, we're going to have to get some better years out of some players. I'm predicting that Boma has a bounce back season. Last year he got 7 points. In 2014-2015, he got 34 points. And the year before that, 15, I'm predicting he gets more than 20 points this year. I think he has to bounce back to stay on that third line. And I'm also predicting that Chiasson's going to have a good year. I know we've all kind of written him off. I'm not sure what kind of offensive production he's going to have yet, but I think that he might be like a better version of Joel Colborne, where he doesn't do a lot offensively. I mean, Colborne was a good offensive guy, but then Chiasson's just going to be a nasty guy to play against and one of those sandpaper guys you need in your lineup. I mean, he got 26 points in 2014-2015, 35 points the year before that, so he can do it. I just don't think on the line he's on, he's going to be doing that.
We'll see. I'm not really expecting anybody to come out like Boma did 2 years ago and like have a brilliant offensive season.
No, like, but I think he's got to do at least 20 points.
Yeah.
Can't do 7 again.
No. For Boma to have a successful season, he has to stay relatively injury-free. And, like, the points will come for him. Like, he's still got his shot. And if he's playing with Backlund and Frolik, he will get offensive opportunities. It's just, he has to stay healthy all year. And I, if he does stay healthy, he will have a bounce back year. One will follow the other. It's just, hopefully he doesn't get hurt with random bizarre injuries like he did last year.
I'm also, for the first time, and we've talked about this, excited about our goalie tandem. We've got Elliott, we've got Johnson. Johnson, I think, is going to get a whole whack of games. It's not like in the past where you only wanted to give the first guy the games. I think Johnson's going to play a whack of games, and I think that's going to be, we've talked about the goalies in the past, but not a lot this week. I think that's going to be a fun pair to watch.
Yep. It's probably the best Flames tandem that we've had since Cujo was backing up Kipper. So,
well, as I said last week, I think it might be one of the best tandems in the league. It's not necessarily the best number one guy, but I think it might be one of the best tandems. Usually you get a really good goalie like Kipper, and nobody knows who the backup is, or it's just some terrible, whoever the cheapest goalie we can find is. So I think we might have one of the best 1-2s. I used to say that about St. Louis with Allen and Elliott, but now we have half of their lineup. I think Pittsburgh's got a good one, but you don't see a lot of 1A, 1B anymore.
No. And the good thing with having two good quality goaltenders is that you're allowed to rest Elliott a bit. Like, you don't need him to go out and play 65, 70 games. Like, Johnson can easily play 30 games this season, so...
Well, even outside of that, I think if Elliott has a bad game, you're more likely to yank him early.
True.
You know, since we've seen in the past where they'll leave the goalie in to get shelled by five or six bad goals. And I think you're going to see Johnson do a lot of mop-up this year.
Yeah. And why not? Like, and vice versa, too. Like, if Johnson has a really bad game, like that one where he gave up three goals on six shots, like, you're just going to... Like, that wasn't a bad game. That was bad luck, but... You know what I mean? Like, you're more apt to just try and wake the team up by switching the goalies, because you do have two viable good goalies. So it's a definite change from last year, where it's like, can anybody stop a puck? So
yeah,
anyone?
And and outside of, say, a devastating injury to Elliott, let's say he got a short-term injury of 10 games, I'm confident enough Johnson could step in for 10.
Well, even then, like, Gillies could easily come up and start as well. Like, Gillies is a good goalie in his own right, so...
Yeah, I think Johnson probably gets the start.
Oh, yeah, well, he'll probably get the majority of starts, but you could easily throw Gillies out there, and it would be just... I think he's in that same bracket of goaltenders as well, so...
We'll see. We haven't seen him play much pro hockey yet.
Yeah, but what I've seen of him, he looks... NHL ready and all that. So, if he wasn't hurt all of last year, I think he'd. I'm not sure that Johnson would be here if he was healthy all year. But, you know, he needs to play a lot in the A. But
it's
It's good that the Flames have three good goaltenders in the organization, and I can't remember the last time you can say that.
Well, I think even Mason McDonald, who's, you know, been reassigned to the ECHL, is a good goaltender. And I think that if I think they're going to have to, I think McDonald could be the best goalie in the ECHL this year.
Probably will.
I think he's pegged to be the next AHL goalie. They're just waiting for a time they can bring Gillies up. And I think they were expecting that to be this year, and plans changed.
Yeah, because of his hip injury, but I think what you'll end up seeing is Elliott be re-signed for like a two-year deal or something like that at some point.
Johnson and, be let go and Gillies take his job?
Exactly. Because I don't see the point in keeping Johnson beyond this year. Like, I like Johnson, but it's...
We'll see how Gillies plays. So, if he's ready, I agree with you. If he's struggling after the hip injury, you might bring Johnson back for another year.
That's a viable way of looking at it.
But, you know, I listened to last year's episode, episode 91, that we did about the same time last year, just for the preseason, and or just for the season started, sorry. We're much more optimistic this year. I think on paper, this is a better, much better lineup than last year. I mean, we're missing guys like Hudler, but I think that we have a better... top to bottom roster, and I think with the new coach we have a better system in play. We're gonna have better, you know, special teams this year. I think everything's going right for the Flames, and it's theirs to screw up again. Like last year, they had some terrible goaltending, they played some terrible games. I think everything's going in their favor, and it's theirs to lose that playoff spot.
Yeah, well, last year, like, I know I predicted that the Flames would have a better season and make the playoffs last year, but I don't think anybody expected half of the team to play like low-end AHL players for the entire year. Like, half had career seasons, the other half were just an absolute disaster. So unless we have that same kind of thing repeat itself where half the lineup just completely falls apart, the Flames should be a playoff team. Like, even if they went 500 in October last year, they would have been a playoff team. So,
I think, though, there's enough. I mean, last year we had some more vets and stuff, but I think this year's roster has enough pieces that could be swapped out that even if our, say, bottom six, you know, Ferland, Hamilton, Chiasson, Boma, Backlund, Frolik, if, say, four of those guys are struggling, you can easily bring four more players up.
And that is a good difference because, like, we don't have that depth.
Last year we saw that they were kind of shy. I mean, 2 years ago they're bringing players up left, right, and center. We saw guys like Juris come up and make the team we didn't expect. Last year we hardly called anybody up, and I think this year they're not going to be gun-shy to start moving players back and forth from Stockton. We saw that with Bolig. I think that Stajan's next. I think that as guys either earn their way on or off the team, we're going to see a lot more transactions.
I can agree with that.
Well, anything else about the opening rosters you want to chat about, Matt?
No, I'm good. I'm just looking forward to tomorrow to watch the Oilers game and be there for the home opener on Friday.
It's going to be a fun home opener. I love that we have back-to-back against the Oilers, and that's a fun way to get things started. And I like there's a bit of a rivalry there already with Versteeg kind of thumbing, you know, the Oilers and signing with us. I think that's cool. I think that the fact that Russell's over there, it just adds a little dynamic to the Battle of Alberta this year.
Yeah, and plus I want to see them win in Edmonton. You know,
yeah,
tarnish the first game in the season in the new building for them.
The first regulation game.
Yeah,
and I believe if you look back at it, actually the first game in the Saddle Dome, I think, was also played against the Oilers.
No, Quebec Nordiques.
Was it the Nordiques? Okay.
Yeah. If I recall, it was something like an 8-8 tie.
Wow.
So, yeah. Fun times.
Well, before we get to our predictions, we did want to give one shout-out to a former Flame, Devin Setoguchi. Flames fans might remember Setoguchi got signed by the Flames a few years ago, didn't really play, looked kind of terrible, reassigned to Stockton. Nobody knew at the time exactly what was going on. It came out later that Setoguchi had some substance abuse problems. And it took a year off, I think, and now he's back, and it looks like he's going to make the LA Kings starting lineup this year, at least their opening day lineup. So good for Devin. I love to see guys turn their life around like that. These guys only have such a short career as it is. You hate for somebody to lose it to substance abuse.
Yeah, I'm glad that the LA Kings gave him an opportunity, and he has taken the most of it, and hopefully he has a good quality season with the Kings and can get another contract after this and hopefully put his career back together.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see what happens. He started the season. He may not, may not stay on the roster. Rennie Bork's back in the NHL. It's just weird that all these guys have sort of disappeared or coming back. But I think part of it goes to the fact that teams are looking for cheap players these days. And if you can get a cheap veteran like a Versteeg, why wouldn't you?
I agree.
Well, Matt, let's look ahead to the first week of the season. It's the 11th when we record this, and it'll be about the 13th by the time everybody hears it, so one game in. But we got three games this week, three rivalry games. We start off on the 12th at Edmonton, as you mentioned, in the new building. Then the Oilers come to Calgary on Friday on the 14th. They're in the Dome, and our first back-to-back of the year, Saturday, we go to Vancouver to play against the Canucks. So I think right in the first week, probably for the first time in a long time, you'll see both goalies play. What do you think? I'll go first, but think about what you think you're going to do for this week for the prediction. As much as I'd love to see the Oilers lose in their building, I think that the Oilers are going to be amped up in that one. I think that they will win in their building, and I think Vancouver will beat us. So of the six possible points, I'm going to say that we get two, and we win the home game against the Oilers.
Okay, well, I'm going to disagree with you there. I think the Flames are going to win in Edmonton. I think they're going to lose in overtime in Calgary, and I think they're going to beat Vancouver. So I'm going to go with 5 points.
So you're going to go 5 points of those. So you think they're only going to drop 1 point this week, and that's an overtime loss in Calgary?
Yeah.
Or an overtime win, I guess. Yeah, so I don't know. I hope you're right. I think this team is going to take a little bit to get going. I think Edmonton's going to be fired up in their own building.
Well, I think that if the Flames were playing better opponents, that they might struggle because of the new system and all that. But the Oilers and the Canucks are terrible hockey teams. Like, I think they're going to be in the bottom five again this year. So, I just don't see them. Like, if they were playing, like, actual teams that should be in the playoffs, then I'd probably agree with you that they might only get 2 points. But their quality of competition for the first five games, they're all bad teams. So,
because after that, we have Buffalo and Carolina come. I just wonder, though, if there's a mental aspect to, you know, we're playing crappy teams. We can sort of play it, you know, 90%.
Yeah.
And if that's the case, I think that could kill the team. I also can see Gullitson doing some experimentation in the first game, which might not give us the best lineups and matchups, especially on the back end. But we shall see. When we talk next week, we'll see. I hope you're right. I think it's possible we could sweep this week and be off to a great start. Historically, this team has bad starts, but I think that we could feasibly get 6 points, and that would be a great way to start off this season.
Yeah, I just think that the Flames overpowering the other teams in terms of talent will overcome any struggles with adapting to the system. That's where I'm thinking 5 or 6. We'll see, though.
And I'm just looking it up here. So if Tkachuk only plays his 10 games, he'll be out of here by the end of the month already. The 30th of this month is the 10 games. So watch Tkachuk carefully this week, everybody, and see how he looks and if you think that he'll be lasting for more than his 10 games. Well, Matt, you enjoy these games. Enjoy the home opener. I'm jealous that you get to go to the home opener. It's always a good time. And I'll be watching intently all three of these games from, I guess, you know, going back to the pub and getting ready for hockey season. But it's nice that hockey's back. I'm excited.
Same here. It's been a long, long, long summer.
It's been a long summer, but it's been an exciting summer.
Yeah. Especially the worry that a lot of Flames fans had about Gaudreau not signing and all that fun stuff. So
I feel so much better today. Gaudreau signed. It's hockey season. You know, we got Versteeg on the lineup. I just feel like today the lineup really came together. And it's go time. Let's do this.
Yep. Well, you have a good week, Dan. And thanks for listening, everybody.
Go Flames, go. Get your red out, boys. Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.